Thank you very much. Today I'm going to talk about Ocean Lotus. I'm going to kind of talk about their digital surveillance and kind of cyber espionage operations and the magnanimity or the scale of it. And I got a good number of slides, although I've been informed I could potentially go a little long. I'm going to try not to, so I'm going to talk as quickly as I can without losing you guys, hopefully. So about me, I mentioned President Volexity. We're a company that has both products and services. We do a lot in the realm of memory acquisition, memory analysis, and we do a lot of time in the world of incident response, forensics, and cyber espionage. So that's what I do a lot of work on. I spend a lot of time with highly targeted groups, whether that's human rights organizations, activists, dissidents, or other groups and people who are kind of at a disadvantage with regards to the entities or individuals that are targeting them. We kind of help them out. So this is both from a professional and as a kind of volunteer type effort. And then just a random aside I'd like to bring up, I'm getting a little less sleep lately because I just became a father for the second time. So my wife is very excited that I'm away from home right now. As for agenda, I'm going to go on a little bit of a background on Ocean Lotus. I mean, some of this stuff, if you're very familiar with them, it should be very familiar. We're going to go into their mass web surveillance campaign, which will have an echo a good amount of what we put out in an older blog regarding it, but it's going to provide a lot more flavor, background, and things that we didn't put publicly, and it's really important to kind of have that to understand Ocean Lotus and just kind of segue into some of the other things that they're doing and we'll talk about. And then last one, I'm not going to talk too much in, but we essentially kind of rewrote the end of this presentation where we were going to really go into more spear phishing, some other things based off of some findings we had related to what they're doing. Pretty interesting. And that's kind of how we're going to close the presentation on some very new research that was getting written up until about 2.5 hours ago. So RSA slide, you got to put in there, what are you going to learn today? Today you're going to learn about Ocean Lotus, who they are, what they're doing, kind of get an understanding for this threat group. And then immediately following the presentation, or basically the second to last slide, we have some resources that are kind of help you defend against, configure your browser, and be a little bit more secure against Ocean Lotus. This specifically apply to any threat group or anything targeting certain resources online and their good practices. But in particular, they apply to a lot of the techniques we'll describe today that Ocean Lotus leverages when it targets different people and organizations. So as a background, just kind of set the stage, again, I understand for those of you that don't know much or don't know anything about Ocean Lotus. In 2015, a Chinese cybersecurity company, Q360, came out and they wrote a pretty detailed report. It's written in Chinese, but I've seen it translated and I've spoken to others. A very good report that kind of details an APT group targeting Chinese government, maritime institutions, shipping, and a bunch of different other things. And it kind of showed some advanced capabilities. And this is one of the first reports from a Chinese company where it's like more of a, like the detail, you drop a bombastic report that's very detailed, very well done, and kind of details a lot of information that's not really out there for the most part. And they kind of said this goes back to 2012 is one of like the earliest dates. And then the attacks are kind of described as state-sponsored, but they didn't name a nation associated with it. They just said, hey, this is Ocean Lotus. As far as I know, I don't believe they brought up any country or attributed it. In the same reference, and to kind of give a little more backstory, they made some reference to Mac malware. Later in February 2016, Alien Vault put out some research regarding Mac malware. They attributed to Ocean Lotus, and the kind of the main takeaway from this report isn't so much exactly what it did or how it did it. It was just that, yes, there's this Mac malware, and what they're doing is actually kind of advanced, had anti-debugging capabilities, and this wasn't some like real rudimentary, basic malware. It wasn't like a piece of Java or Python that ran on Macs. It was like legitimately written for Apple systems and kind of showed that this group had some more advanced capabilities and weren't necessarily just starting out or low on the totem pole in terms of capabilities. Go forward, and then May 2017, and along the way, there's other things that have been published or linked to them that we kind of don't describe. This isn't meant to be a totality of all things ever published regarding Ocean Lotus, just some of the more significant ones as we see it. FireEye published a blog describing several new Ocean Lotus backdoor spear phishing campaigns, and these capabilities that they had once again, developing custom backdoors, kind of interesting. It shows once again they're kind of more advanced in what they can do. And that kind of what they describe is victims or campaigns that had a theme in common where the target wasn't Vietnamese, but the target had business or other interests specifically pertaining to Vietnam. So this report, this blog effectively, some other people are kind of seeing rumbles of this, but publicly and very well documented that Ocean Lotus is most likely or almost certainly a Vietnamese state-sponsored threat group. I mean, when a lot of people think of Vietnam, unless you do a lot of research in this field, it's not a nation necessarily specifically tied with one having a kind of CNE or like attack type capability, and not one that necessarily you would initially expect to be advanced as what some of the capabilities that are being written about. The blog also tied Ocean Lotus to Electronic Frontier Foundation, EFF. They had a blog in 2014 where Vietnamese activists were actually being targeted. And that kind of linked these two things together and starts to paint a bigger picture of, like, certainly this has been around for a while, and they have a few different interests of who they're targeting and has a clear nexus with Vietnam. So then obviously a little bit what we're going to talk about, and I'll jump back to this in a little bit. Volexity, we did a lot of research and we found some really interesting things regarding a very massive, what we consider to be a fairly unparalleled campaign with regards to cyber espionage and mass digital surveillance tracking. I think we kind of, closest thing if you're in this space is a group called Turla, where they compromised a ton of different websites, mostly foreign affairs, embassy websites, but they had some others out there. It's a pretty decent sized campaign. The infrastructure that we see from this dwarfed it by a significant margin. It had a bit more of a narrow focus. Strategic web compromise, or watering holes as some people call them, Chinese shipping and oil, that sounds a little bit familiar from what we saw in the original reporting. Laos, Cambodian, Philippines government, and then Vietnamese interests. And we'll kind of detail and go into that a little bit more in a minute. Now, to step back a little bit further, just to kind of give a little more color to Volexity's kind of experience around what ends up being Ocean Lotus, we worked in incident response in early 2015 for an organization where we picked up some lateral movement, some beaconing activity, and then, like, to this date, not have a real good explanation. Actual proxying of a Metasploit connection, not back to a command and control server, but the actual Metasploit phoning in to get plugin updates and other things, probably a proxy misconfiguration on their part. This organization is an NGO. They deal with Asia, and they specifically deal with issues related to Vietnam, and they are not well favored by the Vietnamese government. They would not operate in Vietnam, and they are someone that Vietnam would not like. That's just relevant to Ocean Lotus, but not something we really considered or knew at the time to be relevant. And the three machines that are compromised in this incident, they all belong to Vietnamese users. So not a domain controller, not a random machine on the network, not another server. Three machines tied back to users that were Vietnamese. They're pretty quick moving. We found that they basically compromised the first machine through a fake Adobe Flash installer. We learn later on, we don't describe it in this presentation, but Ocean Lotus does like to bundle their malware with, I don't know, you call them fake installers or legitimate installers, where they just kind of like bundle their malware in so that it really installs Flash or Firefox or Chrome or the Coke browser, which is built on Chrome, and puts their malware on at the same time. They escalated to admin on the system. They actually used a privilege escalation exploit that was found in the wild. CrowdStrike had detailed this in a blog in late 2014. They used that exact exploit. It was actually not a recreation of it. They must have pulled it out of VirusTotal or somewhere. And they kind of just moved around to those other systems. They did a bunch of lateral operations, used PowerSploit to move around, and once again, more backdoors. They were fairly sophisticated in their capabilities, their movements, and familiarity from our experience of working a lot of incident response. So, at this time, there's still, early March 2015, there's no talk about Vietnam having a cyber espionage capability. We just thought this was a group probably, Chinese in origin. This organization is highly targeted by China and has been for probably close to a decade. And then even when the 360 report that came out, there was no talk of this. We just didn't link two and two together. And once the kind of stuff that came out 2015, 2016, 2017, we kind of really realized what we were dealing with here was Ocean Lotus. We were actually able to attribute and take some of that back and map it ultimately. So now we're going to fast forward to this mass tracking campaign and how we kind of stumbled upon it. And we call it the accidental discovery. It's actually pretty interesting how we ended up finding it. So we stay on a fine spring day in 2017. We got a Scanbox alert from one of our customers that we were monitoring, network monitoring. And if you're not familiar with Scanbox, that's it's an APT framework, it's a Chinese framework, a JavaScript framework that basically profiles the user, checks browser plugins, checks the different things about the browser, gets screen size, all this different data that reports back in. And there's also a keylogger functionality, which a few people have documented, including us, where this was being used on Cisco VPN servers where Chinese APT had exploited a vulnerability in the web VPN to kind of keylog credentials being entered into it. It's believed to be primarily, if not solely, used by Chinese APT. I think the only other time we ever see it come up is PwC or someone that pen tests that either fakes it or has a copy of it and used it. So, it's pretty much exclusively a Chinese APT type tool, although in theory, anyone could potentially have a copy of it, and we have a copy of it. And the examination alert kind of gave us two really interesting pieces of information. The first was that all the callbacks were going back to a domain called ajax-js.com. So, you know, made it look like some kind of JavaScript framework, Ajax, some kind of web stuff that's probably legitimate. And then our refer in this case was mfaic.gov.kh. And this is the Ministry for Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation in Cambodia. So we always find this to be a fairly interesting thing when you see Scanbox on a site, because usually where they show up is, you know, strategically chosen. So someone has breached the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation. It's quite a mouthful for a name. And they install Scanbox on it. And the reason they do this is because they want to then further target profile and get information on the visitors of that site. You have to think about who goes to MFA websites. You know, obviously, other foreign governments could potentially be like citizens and things. And then certainly the government, the government of Cambodia would go there. So it's clearly an interest in who they're targeting. It's kind of interesting to see. So, you know, just a little bit of color to kind of show this. You know, they took a legitimate JavaScript file. As you'll see, this is a pervasive thing that APT groups do these days. I mean, they can throw it in the middle of the, you know, the index or something, but fairly frequently they'll just append a little bit of JavaScript at the end of a legitimate JavaScript file, and then they'll just kind of load it through there. That's exactly what they were doing. And this whole thing kind of made us go, wow, this is kind of interesting, because just 2 weeks earlier, we had a Scanbox alert from that same customer when they were visiting the Ministry of Interior in Cambodia, literally 2 weeks earlier. And that one had a completely different Scanbox URL. I think this one shows up in URL query like 100 times. It might have showed up a few other places, but let me just kind of go, well, that's pretty interesting. We are now 2 weeks in. Our customers, and one in particular, is continually getting Scanbox Chinese espionage through Cambodian government websites, so maybe it would be like some due diligence of ours to go and look at like other Cambodian government websites, because this is clearly a one threat intelligence value, but two, an active threat to our customers. So the first one, very first one we checked, is where the story begins and gets more interesting, is the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, mfa.gov.kh. So let me go back. So unlike with the IC, this website is now defunct. I believe they actually migrated everything from mfa.gov.kh to mfaic. .gov.kh. And the first thing we found, which was fairly interesting, you know, but doesn't mean much, was an orphan JavaScript referencing back to that Scanbox site that we had seen at the beginning of this presentation, mfaic.gov. This could be anything, it could be a link, you know, maybe it's a dead link, but this entire website had no other links to the MFAIC website. So we just kind of made a note, it's a little bit strange, a little bit interesting, but you know, there's nothing online about it. We don't know that this was ever bad, it could be a typo, you know, who really knows. But you know, that was our first kind of thing that said, that's kind of interesting. The next thing we saw, and this is going to go like almost down a little bit of a rabbit trail back to China again, is that the website had a bunch of open directories. So they had directory, they didn't have an index, and it allowed directory listing. And you started looking around, you started seeing files like crypt.dat in an image directory, netcat. You know, usually you're seeing netcat in a images folder on a website, a government website, is usually not a good sign, but you know, you never know, maybe that's where they like to put it. And then there's also this file called msbuild.log. Well, that crypt.dat and that msbuild.log end up both being 64-bit executables that were both backdoors for a group, a Chinese APT group called Leviathan Green Crew APT 40. So here we are in files from early 2017, mid 2017. On Cambodian websites from a group that was just kind of in the news yesterday a couple times now. FireEye had a blog 2 days ago, and then Accenture iDefense went with the Wall Street Journal and kind of detailed universities being targeted for maritime research. They also go after medical data and other things. And this is the same group. FireEye did a blog maybe a number of months ago about them going after Cambodia ahead of the elections back in like kind of mid or earlier 2018, and they've clearly been in there a lot longer than that. We can't link these to the Scanbox, but clearly there's a lot of problems and issues with the government and the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Cambodia. So kind of an interesting finding, and this literally has nothing to do with Ocean Lotus, but it's what we found, and it's pretty fascinating to kind of run into this. So how we get back to what we're going to go in the mass surveillance, we looked at another file on the site called jwplayer.js. Jwplayer is like a kind of framework tool that lets you play videos and things within a website. It's a legitimate thing, is used by this website. But we found that in one of the files, at the end of it, similar to how you saw earlier, the Scanbox framework, is a reference to this domain, JSCORE, but you look over here, jscoregroup.com. And basically, it would effectively load this URL. So we see some JavaScript designed to load JavaScript from another website that's broken up into multiple pieces. That doesn't necessarily mean it's bad, but usually that's a pretty good indicator that someone's trying to hide something or evade detection or make it harder to find what's going on within a file. If we started looking a little bit closer, they obviously used JDB Player, like I mentioned. And we looked at a system that was accessing this website. We also ran this ourselves and researched this 10 ways to Sunday. But we basically showed and downloaded jwp.js, 48 kilobyte file. And it showed a bunch of follow-on requests, once that got loaded from the website, that got pretty interesting. The first thing we saw was a SSL link to a website called healthrayid.com asking for robot.txt. That's not robots, like a typical file for like browser or crawlers and things, it's robot singular. And then when we checked that file, we saw it was returning a GUID value. The interesting thing is if you hit that robot.txt file, text you'd expect to be static, every time you would refresh it, the value would be completely different. So this is a dynamic file that's a text file with a weird name, and it's being loaded by JavaScript that we're finding on the Foreign Affairs website. Kind of interesting. And then we start seeing some more requests like this, a URL back to JSCOR group with base64 code in it. And then we start seeing big requests. And if you try to read all that or write that down, I'd be very, very impressed. But I can give you the slides later if you want. And you start to see these long URLs and these long things that are going to. And the URLs get really crazy. Some of them are a little bit longer. And it's basically a bunch of base64, decodes very cleanly. That first URL from earlier just looks like this, some UUID, a ZUUID. And you'll notice there's a GUID value here. That's the value that was actually taken from that robot.txt file. So we can see there's a couple sites interacting to build queries and do some interesting things here. And we start looking at it, and that long URL decodes to this, and kind of cleaned up a little bit so it's easier to read. It's starting to collect information about the user. So that first request, the long but not the longest one, starts getting information about the browser, the user, the user agent string and whatnot, and breaks it into different pieces. Checks for different plugins, does it have ActiveX and so on, MIME type information. And it's starting to collect some kind of interesting data. And then you start seeing this, it's a kind of an interactive process. The browser is just sitting there in the background and is doing all this kind of activity that just keeps looking like this. And we start digging in a bit more. It's sending stuff like the title of the page it's on, the refer, the client's cookies, the URL that it was accessing specifically. And then it's getting stuff called a client network IP list. And you'll see here, there's RFC 1918 IP. So it's actually using WebRTC to go in and get information about the user's IP address on their machine and not just what it looks like externally. And then other data that it starts collecting from it. So this visiting the Ministry of Foreign Affairs kicks off all this kind of activity, and there's a bunch of stuff. And we basically figured out this is a framework that's collecting all this data from Ocean Lotus, and we kind of named it, Framework B. And at this point, we're just not seeing any exploit attempts, though. It's just kind of sending all this information. So it's collecting a lot of data. It's stuff that, some ad networks and other things kind of collect this data. It's not necessarily, it's definitely suspect. It's something you generally don't want happening. It's super shady, but it's not actually doing anything truly malicious at this point. We start to research it a little. Could this be just some weird little ad network or something else going on that it just looks really bad, but some places they do really strange stuff. So we kind of started investigating it. And we have those two domains that are new, the JSCOR group one and the healthrayid.com domain. Our first one here, it basically turned up nothing. Anything we looked in, other traffic, other websites, using risk IQs, passive total, Googling it, whatever we looked into, we got absolutely nothing on it. It's kind of a dead end. However, when we started looking into healthrayid.com, we kind of started unraveling a really staggering amount of infrastructure that kind of led us to a bunch of other domains that were doing something similar with that robot.txt file. This is probably a little bit hard to read for you, but this is an old screenshot of an old kind of Redmine wiki that we used to use, and it was just kind of where we were jotting down our notes, and it's just this page, it would go on for about, by the time we were done, this is probably about a 30th of the sites that we found. Pretty impressive number of sites, but basically it started with MFA, then we started seeing Cambodian news websites, then we started seeing the National Police of the Philippines, the Armed Forces Military, Armed Forces Philippines Military website. We started seeing websites related to religion, which is a hotbed topic in Vietnam, and a bunch of other websites that have to do with kind of speaking out or media or things that are potentially not pro Vietnamese government or our other foreign governments surrounding Vietnam. And then in particular, this story takes an interesting turn when we get to a very high-profile website. I don't know how many people here are familiar with ASEAN. It's the Association for Southeastern Asian Nations. They're kind of like a cooperative of Southeast Asian nations that kind of a more economic focus. A really horrible way would think of it, which is be wholly inaccurate, and I'm sure a policy person would lambast me, but you know, think of like kind of like NATO, if you know, NATO, but not you know, without defense. You know, they kind of support one another in multilateral trade and they do other things, but don't have a kind of defense pact. But it's a very well-known organization, very high profile. You'll have a lot of foreign government leaders from the United States, Europe, and other people who go and speak at their summit. So it's like an internationally recognized thing and not just a like clubhouse that is like closed off. It's a very well-known organization. But of particular interest of this is what you'll see up here. And why this site matters so much, not just from being compromised, but to the story of Ocean Lotus, is that we listed twice on the table because we ended up finding something along our first one. We had a JavaScript file, but then we had this other domain and this kind of URL which has like some parameters on as part of the URI and not just a .js extension. So we found two suspect JavaScript entries on the ASEAN website. That new one was like wasn't like the others, wasn't like our framework B. Was this domain called cloudflare-api.com. And like we said, it has like kind of this little ending extension, which we'll talk about a little bit later. And it was a large blob of JavaScript that provided a whole bunch of function, MD5 hashing, Base64 encoding and decoding, sets variables and does other functions. And then you'll see here kind of like what it looks like inside. It collects information on the system, has an actual encryption key, which I'll talk about in a minute, and even has a receiving URL where to send the data, which it says icon.jpg. And you'll notice the V value here matches what the initial JavaScript was, kind of as an identifier. So then the framework basically collects the same information, or it's essentially the same type of information as our framework B. It Base64 encodes it in its text and when it sends it off. But it has one little difference in it, and that it actually does proper encryption and encrypts all of it. So if you were looking at this through proxy logs, you were looking through this at network traffic and it was unencrypted, or you're intercepting SSL, you would not be able to just Base64 decode it and see what you're looking at. You'd actually have to go through a proper decryption routine to see the data. So they kind of added a little bit of something extra on there to make it a little bit harder to figure out what's actually going on with it. And we call this one here, so going forward, framework A. And then this is the only place to date where we ever found framework A and framework B deployed on the same site. And it actually was very helpful because it started letting us unravel a bit more of what Ocean Lotus was doing. We don't know why they had both on there. It could just be someone didn't notice, or competing factions within the organization. We don't know a lot about their structure, but it was very interesting to see that nonetheless. So one of the things, and this definitely isn't something we've published about previously, but it's, we've mentioned it or it's been brought up. You may have seen this discussed if you know someone who's talked to us or anything. But during our investigation, besides that kind of profiling framework, which is like the gist of the main purpose of the frameworks that we see, we found a version that basically of framework A that we just talked about that did keylogging. And specifically, that V value is unique for each site that it ends up on. And that V value will determine what gets returned. So the JavaScript that does all the profiling, unless your V value is related to a different type of site where a keylogger is going to be pushed down instead of a profiling site. So what we observed so far was OWA, the kind of like the Outlook web access or for Exchange, like the web interface for Exchange, and Zimbra. If you're not familiar with Zimbra, you'll have a picture in a minute, see what it looks like, but it's a, they do support, and you can have a paid model, but it's an open source or free alternative to kind of like Exchange that a lot of organizations use as well. And what it does, the framework looks for specific username password fields depending on the type of site it's deployed on, and it will collect that data and send it back to Ocean Lotus. So for example, one of the sites that it was on was the Philippines National Security Council. I don't know about you, but that sounds like the type of email you might not want your foreign government to be reading, but that could be just me. Zimbra here, if you looked in their source, they had some JavaScript. That JavaScript referenced this long, kind of legitimate looking URL, except for that absolutely doesn't belong there. That is not part of Zimbra at all. And if you looked at that, you would end up seeing a blob of JavaScript that would load that framework A. In this case, from a bogus Google domain. So jquery.google.js.com, and that would hook into the browser and basically let them, like anyone who goes and logs into that webmail, keylog all their data. We found a bunch of other fake Google sites, and this will be like a theme, and we'll have a slide later about the brand impersonation that they do to try and blend in. But a lot of these were framework A, just create a lot of domains that kind of look like legitimate Google stuff if you were looking closer. Not really relevant to a Zimbra page, but perhaps in some of the other frameworks and other websites they put this in, it would blend in a bit more. Keyloggers, some of the sites that we found it on, non-comprehensive. The National Security Council we mentioned, the Chinese National Oil Company, Chinese shipping companies, the Armed Forces, the Philippines military website, and then a pretty interesting one, which kind of aligns with some research we would end up doing later, where the Ministry of Interior within Vietnam was also being keylogged by Ocean Lotus. That's interesting and important because we ended up finding out, and this is not described in this research, Ocean Lotus has a heavy focus and does a lot of operations internally against its own companies, different government agencies, different cities, federally, and even going after like ISPs and other things that provide services to citizens within the country. They have a fairly robust internal targeting campaign that we're not going to get into a lot today for a number of different reasons, but this ended up aligning with some of their other operations internally. It's interesting to see that as kind of like an outlier to the rest of what we talk about. We did a good amount of research into this, and we kind of touched on this earlier, but the targets kind of emerged from it. They were going after Cambodian government media, Philippines military and government, Laotian government, and then these Vietnamese-focused NGOs and individuals. And it turns out those individuals and NGOs were the vast majority of what they were actually going after, at least from initially. And this is basically NGOs and people who would be at odds with the Vietnamese government, who speak out against them, are upset them, are critical of them. And the first one we kind of like, you know, saw a lot and kept seeing come up was this thing called Formosa Hot Tin Steel Blog. This is a Taiwanese steel company. They have a big plant in Vietnam. And there was a major disaster where they dumped a ton of cyanide and other chemicals into the water, and it killed a lot of, people died from it, people got sick, and a lot of fish and wildlife died from it. And it sparked a lot of protests within Vietnam. Vietnam, they ended up getting fined over it, but it's ended up causing a lot of clash where people had a disagreement with the government, the way it was being treated or potentially covered up or who was being held accountable. And a number of different bloggers and different people were actually arrested for being involved with protests or blogging about this. I'm given pretty draconian sentences for covering this disaster between 8 and 10 years in prison and basically convicted in kangaroo courts where they really, you know, they don't get to present a defense, they're just sentenced to jail. This blog in particular will come up later, so it's pretty interesting. There's a blog that was compromised, and it details all this. It's meant for activists to read and get interested in, and we'll talk about this towards the end. Human rights defenders, literally people helping human rights, but also humanrightsdefenders.net, and a bunch of news and media websites, religious, as we mentioned earlier, things going with religion, specifically Catholicism, and then websites exposing the mistreatment of activists, foreign Vietnamese prisoners of conscience, and all these other websites showing arrests and beatings and things like that. And it was just a ton and ton of different websites. And we looked at it, where are all these websites? You know, they're very targeted, very specific. You know, once again, we know this is Ocean Lotus. There's only one type of entity that would actually be interested in, the number of victims and targets here. It only would make sense. And the platforms were Joomla, Drupal, WordPress, Blogger, Blogspot, all over the place. And they had numerous methods of loading their JavaScript. So it wasn't like someone took the same domain, the same piece of code, and shoved it in a bunch of sites. They would take time. They would look at different scripts loaded by of the site. They would load it in. They would put it in different places, different variable names, different domain names. Someone spent a good amount of time trying to make this blend in and make it kind of hard to detect. So in doing so, they use a bunch of different domains. So brand impersonation, this is a non-comprehensive slide, but specifically, you know, we mentioned Cloudflare and Google earlier. They have a bunch of others. This is a good list of where they have domains, mostly for web tracking and other things, but some of these are also used in some of their malware campaigns. They are big on creating domains that look very similar or look like some of the tracking or the Google user content, things like that. So if someone's looking at, presumably network traffic or things like that, or looks a little bit deeper, they'll just think that, hey, that's legitimate and kind of ignore it. So targeting whitelists. So we still are at this point, we have all these frameworks and little to no action. So like what gives, like what are they actually doing? What is the point of all this? Okay, we got a key logging activity, that's very direct. That makes a lot of sense. It's on a very specific portion of certain types of websites. But we have all these other websites that are in a given day, probably in the hundreds of thousands, if not millions of visitors a day. So what are they doing? And this is a kind of a technique that's been adopted by both Chinese, Russian, APT for a number of years now. We kind of surmise that they must have some kind of profiling and whitelist to be able to put this code on very high profile websites, on a lot of websites, but not one, expose themselves, or two, end up targeting kind of like an untenable number of victims. So if I put if I go after a million people and I get only 1%, I've got an insane amount of like stuff to manage and my exposure is way higher. So we think they have a whitelist, and we kind of, some research that we're doing, we start to suspect that if you're on their whitelist, you'll get a fake logon page, or you'll get presented with a malware download. So one of the organizations we work with, the one we did the incident response for in 2015, turns out they're a high priority target for Ocean Lotus. And some of the work we did with them, we kind of confirm based on network security monitoring as well as like on-site actual testing that they are actually using a whitelist and employing it, and we get to see actually how it works. In our testing, you know, we were able to kind of verify this. The interesting part, an aside, we were doing all this research, and that customer, like you said, they have a group that deals with Vietnam. We actually asked, can we go in and brief this department? You know, they compromised three machines before, but they have about 11 or 12 people in this department dealing with Vietnam. And we said, hey, can we come in and brief it? And we want to give them a list of the domains, see if they know any of these sites or if they've seen anything weird. And we went in there and we gave the director, we talked to the staff. And at the end of it, one of the staff said, I was on this news site this morning, which was about an hour and a half before we were there. And I got a login for Google when I went to this site. And that seems kind of strange and not what I was expecting. And we were like, what are the odds that we came here? This has been going on for so long. And an hour and a half before we went there to talk about it, someone actually had experienced it. So we went there to their site, and we went to this website of Moksang Media. They're a Vietnamese news channel that's operated by an organization called Boat People SOS, BPSOS, which is a US-based NGO that deals with Vietnamese like rights and issues operating in the United States and Southeast Asia. They're okay with their name being mentioned. We work with them and got their approval for all this. So they're a pretty good organization, and they are someone that the Vietnamese government does not like in the least. And we found if you went to moksangmedia.com from the machine of the woman we were speaking with, it would load the website in the background, kind of like you see, but then slowly and very nicely, this like it would gray the background out and this like window would pop up. It would fade in really slowly, like a very professional looking thing on Internet Explorer. If we went to the machine from Chrome, it would slowly fade in. We would see the site for a second, it would slowly fade in this take Chrome anywhere pop-up and ask you to sign in, or you say no thanks. And basically, regardless if you hit sign in or no thanks, you ended up in the same place. It didn't really matter which option you chose. You would end up on accounts.google.com, a login OAuth. So this is not a fake site. This isn't a bogus domain that Ocean Lotus created. You would actually end up on a legitimate Google OAuth page. And you would see a sign in. They had a domain called, it says, please watting for minutes. Not the most stealthy component or thing they could have come up with, but apparently they developed an app, and that's the domain that they operated it under. And this is the point at which you would then, a person would be asked to log in. So the targets kind of lead to, you know, they think that, hey, I'm just going to get access to other content, or I'm going to follow it. And you ask, hey, why Gmail? Like, it's on, you know, what if they don't have Gmail, or they have Outlook, you know, or they, you know, use Office, or they don't use anything. Gmail, especially in the Vietnamese community, definitely in the office of the person who got this pop-up, it's a very popular thing to use. They do a lot of their business outside of their corporate email, and they do it on Gmail. They communicate with their friends on Gmail. And I guess it's probably a good odds. If they didn't have some way they profiled them as having Gmail, they had a good shot in the, you know, at it in the dark to say that these people actually use Gmail. Because I think out of the 12 people, all 12 of them had Gmail accounts. So wasn't a horrible guess to go after this. And basically, you know, they say, hey, you want to get extra content, log in here. It's an OAuth page that will give access to the visitor's account. And then after, even if you log in at that point, you get one last opportunity. And this is true of any application with Google you have access to kind of bail out. And you'll get this little pop-up that says, hey, this thing wants to get access to, you know, read, send, delete, and manage your email, view your contacts, view your history. And this is a very intrusive application. A lot of people give applications access to things. This type of privilege and access is not something that is typical, not something you would usually want, and definitely it's not something you'd want to get to a foreign government that's targeting you. So with this, you can look in a little deeper. With all Google apps, you can see like an email is registered to. This may or may not mean anything. It was richard.bailey9388@gmail.com. So I mean, it's you know, that could be legitimate, but you know, it kind of stands out if you're taking a little bit closer look. And then, you know, even if you wanted to take it a little bit step further, you give it access to your account. You'd get a little part in Google that tell you that, well, a news provider, the name of that app, connected from Kiev, Ukraine, into your email. Which, you know, maybe that's good, maybe it's not. you dig in a little closer, and I blur some of this out for different investigator operational reasons. If you really want the IP, contact me later. The IP address belongs to Freehost. It's a VPS provider. It's a VPS provider used heavily by Ocean Lotus, one of many. Out of the Ukraine, that's where it's connecting from. And then if we dig a little bit further, and we go into, if you're familiar with Gmail, if you go to the actual email screen, bottom right, there's a little like, look at the activity of what's logged in to your account and whatnot, that kind of activity, recent activity monitor. The first one you can ignore, that's us. The bottom one is that application, it's been authorized, and it's connecting from an IP address in the United States. That IP address belongs to DigitalOcean. DigitalOcean, Vulture Chupa, and a few others. Well, Vulture Chupa, same company, DigitalOcean, heavily used by Ocean Lotus, and that's Ocean Lotus' application that's logging in. And if you kind of kept an eye on the screen, that was like, usually, I don't know, I said 8 minutes, almost every time we looked, it said checked a minute ago. It's like an application that constantly connects in. And we can surmise what they're doing. Like, even if you give an app authorization to do this stuff, you don't, you know, unless you admin the app, you can't see what it actually does. But it's pretty logical that, you know, it probably connects in and downloads email contacts and whatnot. It also gives, you know, clearly they could send email on behalf of a victim too, but this might start to explain why some of these block spot pages are compromised. It might start to explain like why they would want to get access to the infrastructure from what we're seeing. And an interesting aside is with the Google OAuth, this, you know, these answers and these things are not unique to Ocean Lotus as anything that could be using this threat. This allows people to completely bypass two-factor on the account. So they could have multi-factor app passwords for their phones and other things. Once you do that Google OAuth authorization, that allows them to completely bypass, and that security is out the window. There are some things, I'll have it on the second to last slide. There's some advanced security features you can have that can mitigate this, but they're not very common. Like, they're not a common thing. You have to take some extra steps. But that's kind of interesting that they kind of developed a way that could maintain access that didn't require them to have two-factor. So post-blog activity. So we blogged about this stuff. We put a lot of information out there. We burned a lot of what they're doing purposefully. And we know that Ocean Lotus viewed our blog within 24 hours. We have a lot of telemetry and kind of interesting background information. We know where they come from for certain activity. We know they saw our blog. And shortly after our blog, within 48 hours, a lot of those activist websites, the human rights NGOs, they took the malicious JavaScript out of the Java, you know, out of the source. So if you went there, it was no longer serving up anything malicious. They didn't do this for a lot of the, they did it for ASEAN as well, but, or we reached out to a lot of them. I don't know who moved it versus they moved it in some cases. But they removed a lot, but they left in a lot of the Cambodian government sites, even though it basically was dead at that point because some DNS providers and people took action on it. But they didn't remove their web shell. So they kept their access, and then they also maintained usernames and logons. So a lot of these sites, when they compromised them, they backdoored them, they put web shells there. They also gained legitimate credentials from some of our investigations. So they maintained access to the site, but removed the code that made it obvious when people were looking, or specifically looking at essentially what we had found. And I also would not be surprised and suspect, based on our research, that if at some point Ocean Lotus will likely view this presentation. It seems more than likely, given they are very aware and abreast of when people talk about them in research. So that is just a little tidbit, and I think they'll see anything that's mentioned here today as well. But business as usual. Ocean Lotus spear phishing right after that into early 2018. It just continued, didn't slow down. If anything, it looked like it got busier, but we also had a lot more activists and dissidents kind of sharing information with us, so it's kind of hard for us to measure did it actually increase. We just got more reporting at that point. And then the kind of web profiling campaign, as we mentioned, it scaled back pretty dramatically. But in early 2018, it kind of resurfaced, and mostly on Cambodian government websites. So I don't know if that specifically aligns with elections. It kind of stayed true for a while, even past the elections. But no profiling, almost none in Laos, Philippines, and China. Virtually, there's some stuff going on. And then there was a light focus on these Vietnamese language sites that we saw, just a couple of them, like literally less than 10, like we would find. In mid to late 2018, Ocean Lotus started to reemerge more on the Vietnamese blogs and activist networks. We saw that happening, and then ESET put out a blog, the link's down there, but if you go search ESET and Ocean Lotus, it's from November, where they described majority, they cover some of the Ministry of Defense and other things we've been looking at in Cambodia, but the majority of Vietnamese websites they popped up on, they have 21 sites on their list, and the majority of those are like legacy compromises. They're sites that either the code kind of died off and was still there. The majority of them, the Ocean Lotus had briefly taken the code off and put it back. Most of that infrastructure that they blogged about has been completely dead and abandoned. One interesting thing they did was they put a different site for each, you know, each one of the compromised websites. They put a unique host name with it. Let me cover that here in a minute. And some of the other changes they did were they started obfuscating their code more. So I remember earlier we saw they broke up the variables a little bit. It was like very rudimentary, kind of simple stuff. You could eyeball it and see it a lot easier. But they started doing stuff like Dean Edwards packing the code, really splitting things up, breaking up variables. So like one word would be put in like five variables and like recombine. They would put domain names and other things, URIs backwards and use JavaScript to like reverse the text when they like reformulate it for the browser. And then things like using numeric representations of letters to build up. So if you even search components. So, you know, if you knew there was a Z in the domain, that's uncommon, you wouldn't find it. You'd see like a string, a character representation of it. And another big thing that we saw them do, and this one is actually kind of, you'll see it a good bit in the ESET blog, is they started using dynamic DNS. So before we showed those Google domains, we had that sort of thing where they created all those domains with those different brands. They register and own these domains. Like we have a list of, I think, 600 or 700 domains they own. They have a massive amount of infrastructure. In doing so, they kind of switched over to dynamic DNS, which we really hadn't seen them. We saw them experiment a couple things with malware, but they started doing this with both profiling. As you can see in the ESET blog, the majority of their host names are actually Dyn Corporation, owned by Oracle, host names. And then they were using that for both profiling and for malware. And kind of one of the interesting things that they did, which is very well displayed in the ESET blog, each one of those sites, you don't see any overlap in both the stage one or the stage two domains they were using. So they really started, like what they learned from our blog, and it's kind of to be expected, is they started trying to separate things so it's a little bit harder to unravel or map things back. They tried to do a little bit more OPSEC on finding one site compromised, not making it easy to find the other through a number of different means. So we fast forward to new in 2019, and the majority of these slides and data here is stuff that we actually just realized and created last week. This was going to be a big thing about spear phishing and some of their tracking they do with Yesware, but that got nixed because we found some really interesting stuff that they're doing. So ESET, after that, they've killed off most of this stuff. Even though the domains are still there, they're not active. They've been reassigned. The DigitalOcean or Vulture IPs are like now been reassigned to new customers, things like that. And we found recently on a single site and potentially two sites, they're using a framework called Matomo. So previously, these JavaScript and other things is a hodgepodge of different profiling and fingerprinting and things that they created or took from others and kind of Frankenstein into one big kind of framework. But now we see that they started using Matomo. And Matomo is like completely legitimate. Don't read into this to think Matomo is bad or anything illegitimate of Matomo. It's used in hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of different websites use it. It was formerly known as PyWik. It's an open source framework to get analytics for visitors to your website. So if you're not using like Webalizer or Google Analytics, something like this is a very powerful, it's a lot of graphs and really cool looking stuff. It collects a lot of data from your visitors. It's meant to be, I want to collect a bunch of stuff and you can kind of turn on what features you want. It uses a JavaScript client, so a JS file that loads, and a PHP receiver, which is a kind of common theme. It makes sense. Exactly what OceanLoaders does. That's generally how profiling frameworks work. And it collects all that data. And then one interesting thing, which we'll talk about in a minute, it supports customized variables. So out of the box, it collects a bunch of interesting stuff, the type of stuff a website owner would want to know about a visitor, and sends it back. But you can also kind of customize and put other things in it if it's not already collecting what you want. So this website called Ting Kongle is a news website for a graphic meeting, but this is the kind of stuff that's happening to people that they report on. Is a news website that's like pretty popular. I don't know if this stat counter, they claim it's got millions of visitors. It's very well likely possible. We went there and actually found, when we looked on it, it's one of the sites that's been compromised for a while, perpetually, for a very, very long time. And there may not be a coincidence in this. But in there was Matomo code. And the Matomo code went to track.leadsdonut.com. We just found this, I think, on Friday or Saturday this week. So this is like brand new. This is normal Matomo code. This is what it should look like. This is how Matomo operates, Matomo.js. Out of the box, this is kind of like basically what it should do and how it should look. And it reports all this data back. But then we find something. They use a custom variable parameter. So you could look at that and think, oh, maybe this website is just deciding to use Matomo, track its visitors. OceanLotus is gone. And the website owner said, oh, I've kicked OceanLotus out. Now it's time for me to start tracking my visitors separately. Except for we see a little bit of an interesting thing where the custom variable was used for WebRTC, the little kind of plugin that lets you collect that information. In this case, it will get the IPv4, the external IP, and the IPv6 of the visitor. So we can see our OceanLotus, who favors WebRTC, has added that into this, and we believe they've been kind of testing and experimenting with it. We've been poking on it and actually removed the code from that website last night at some point. We don't know if that's from our poking or to make our presentation look bad, or they're just testing it right now. But this is what's in the code. Now, when I mentioned earlier, they have all these domains. Google.js, there's Akamai, there's 100 plus of them from back in 2017. If you went to those domains, google-js.com, Cloudflare API, you get a blank page or you get a fake 404. There was nothing behind it. There wasn't a redirect to Google or anything like that. It would just go nowhere. Well, it turns out in this case, if you remember, I'll go back real quick, right there, Leeds Donut. If you go to leadsdonut.com, unless they took it down in the last hour, you'll end up with a website that looks just like this. A very nice website, a responsive website. It works in your phone as a mobile version of it. Very cool looking website. And it says, you know, we are a variety of unique features. Give you a 360 view on your visitors. They have 648 happy clients. They have, they've almost got a number of clients to lines of code, 900 lines of code. And they've won 263 awards. This is like an impressive number of awards for a company of this magnitude. And they get all this, like a bunch of stuff. And this page is scrolled, is really nice, and the thing is, it shows like typing. It's like a really nice website. And they've won all those awards since, I guess, December 27th of last year. So they've won all this, those hundreds of awards at the last basically 2.5 months. And then they also created this and have no like web presence on this website. You can't actually sign up or log in anywhere. And it basically just created a site to kind of legitimize their tracking. So we think they're experimenting now a little bit more to try and make it blend in. It's pretty interesting. So the biggest thing that we have to kind of reveal today, which is a particular interest and ties back to all of this, is we discovered with high confidence some of these sites we've been looking at, we had assumed were compromised, a deal with activists, in particular like Formosa Steel, these anti-corruption blogs, big news websites. We've been kind of tracking those compromised. ESET has a few of them they list as compromised by Ocean Lotus as well. But we got some information and some research which basically said, well, you could call them compromised, but it turns out Ocean Lotus is actually operating them, owns the domain, curates the content, and posts everything to the site. So some of those sites we're looking at that are encouraging activists to do things, reposting articles, fighting against Vietnam or Formosa Steel Plant. Well, it turns out Ocean Lotus is curating and running all of that. And they also maintain some social media presence with Facebook pages and Facebook groups. And the sites are like news or activist websites. And then we also found that they're using a bunch of doppelganger domains in some cases with profiling code, exploit code. We've been seeing them test flash exploits recently. And then keyloggers on some websites designed to look like Chinese government webmail servers. A little bit different than the keylogging framework we saw earlier. So the Formosa Hot Tin Steel blog is the activist website, is one we've been tracking. It's been perpetually compromised. Turns out the reason it always looks like it's compromised by Ocean Lotus is Ocean Lotus owns that domain. They operate this website, and this is actually completely run by them. They had a Facebook page. You'll find that all the Facebook references I get now as of this morning, they appear to no longer work. There could be a reason behind that. Maybe they're not legitimate. They have a number of different followers. They would frequently post articles on there, linking back to the websites that they control. In this case, they have a couple hundred followers. But you might remember that website earlier, Ting Kong Lei, big news website, the one that we kept seeing. This is named an ESET. We've been tracking it for a better part of a year and a half. It's compromised. This turns out to be a pretty popular one. They have a Facebook page and group. And this one, if you look on there, they have 20,000 followers. So when they post something, it goes out to a very large number of people. It's a pretty good way to kind of keep track of who's interested in what and other ways you might target someone. As of this morning, this site will no longer function either. If you want screenshots or anything, let me know. Otherwise, some of this should still be in Google Cache. So basically, we found that Ocean Lotus is taking targeting of dissidents, activists, and other people to the next level to where instead of simply just compromising websites and hoping that no one finds or removes them, they started curating content on blogs, on websites to basically bring the activists and people to them, potentially interacting with them, and certainly tracking them. And then here's a list. I don't have the Ting Kong Lei one on here, but Formosa, this is the anti-corruption blog. This one is actually a little bit odd, and it's a website that deals with getting escorts, like female companionship. So that's apparently something they want to keep track of and deal with there. And then we have a series of different domains that are representative of. One is a professor who posts a lot of stuff that kind of pisses off Vietnam. They created that, and have a doppelganger domain that profiles visitors. And then some other corporations. One's a big food corporation. Another one deals with like school supplies and everything. Another one's a giant real estate firm where they kind of, we don't know the targeting, but they've kind of spoofed, mirrored these domains and put either exploit code or tracking code on it. So kind of that's where we're going to leave this presentation in terms of like what they're up to. We're going to close there. So from our perspective, closing thoughts, Ocean Lotus kind of a proven that they can conduct some really large scale operations. I know we've talked a lot about here, but it's a very impressive the amount of servers and infrastructure they have involved here. It's a tiered architecture, it's proxied. They have a lot of stuff going on. It's very hard to maintain that. It's pretty much unparalleled. And then the kind of most shocking thing out of this, which we were kind of surprised to see, is that they've conducted multi-year operations running fraudulent or completely fabricated content and websites designed to target largely dissidents and activists who think that who they're talking to or what they're reading is actually legitimate. And then, you know, they actively compromise networks of individuals, corporations, and they break into a number of different places. And they've been able to maintain a foothold. And from our own seeing them operate in 2015, they're fairly, while they made some mistakes, they're up there with some of like the better tier in terms of lateral movement and other activity. And then based on some of research and other things today, we just kind of basically think they're going to continue to be a rather formidable threat. And please, I'm going to be in the hallway. I know I'm running. I'm already out of time. So I'll chat in the hallway. I don't think we'll have time for questions unless I'm wrong. But a couple resources real quick. These both pertain to checking your Gmail account or how you can lock it down with, like I mentioned, further locking it down, the last two. And the first one is from Andrew Case. He's our director of research here at Volexity. He runs a very popular and well-known blog, if you search this, Privacy and Security Conscious Browsing. And basically, it's a detailed resource for how to configure your browser to be more secure, deal with tracking and privacy. And it covers Internet Explorer, Edge, Chrome, and Firefox, and in particular, the resources like how to disable WebRTC, the thing that's getting your internal IP address and letting someone map out your network just by browsing a website, is covered amongst many other things in there. And that's a generic good thing to follow and certainly something that will help you deal with like Ocean Lotus or similar threats. And with that, I appreciate your time and I will be in the hallway if anyone wants to chat. And you can always, if you email me, I'll be more than happy to respond if you want to talk there too. So thank you very much.